Let's have a brief look at the organization of this course, in particular the regulations, in order to get exam admission. So the lecture, as you have seen, is organized in OLAT, and the script should be available by now already. It's available in English and in German. This has historic reasons, because the lecture was and still is, to some extent, like a bachelor course. So this is offered or was offered in German. And now it's also a master course. The content didn't change, but since I had to translate the slides anyway, I kept the German version, so we have both. Official is the English one, and the videos that I will create are also showing, obviously, the English version, and the videos will solely be in English. We offer exercises. They're mandatory to attend in order to get exam qualification. There will be two exercise sessions offered, and you're free to pick any of the two. The organization of the exercise is done by Angela Davidkova and Nico Schäfer, and the exercise sessions are held by Damian Trifonovic and Nils Altenhofen. One exercise session will be offered Wednesday at 12 and Friday from 12 the other one. Yeah. So you only have to attend one of the two. You don't have to attend. Yeah, there's not many mandatory attendance, but as we will discuss in a minute, you have to solve exercise sheets and get a certain amount of points throughout the semester. About the exam, I mentioned already that the exam requires you to successfully participate in the exercise sheets or in the sessions. You have to reach a certain amount of points. No mandatory attendance, as I said. We, of course, have people here that took the exercise sheets already last year and they achieved exam qualification but did not attempt the exam yet. These previous exam qualifications are still valid. And of course, if you have already attempted once and you failed, this also, of course, allows you to write, obviously, the exam upcoming. Unfortunately, we don't know yet when the exam will take place. Usually, we have at least some temporary dates from a planning, but in the current situation, we don't have this. But the current plan is, like in the previous years, there will be two exams offered. One usually in mid of February and the other one end of March. And let's hope that the situation will be next year a little bit better, so we can have these exams in these time frames. So the rules for exercise participation, which you need for exam admission, you have to register in OLAT. I guess you all have done this, otherwise, well, at least you found the videos and the slides. And access code to OLAT, which probably you know already, is integer. So how to get admission to the exam? There will be 50 assignments distributed over 12 exercise sheets. The first sheet is released in the first week of the semester. For every assignment, there can be maximum 1 point gained if the solution is complete and mostly correct. Yeah, it doesn't have to be fully correct, but it should be pretty much correct. Otherwise, you're not getting this 1 point. In order to get admission to the exam, you need 35 out of 50. And we have seen this in the past, that people say, oh, this is so much, 35 out of 50. But again, note that this does not mean 1 point is only given for the correct, so the fully correct solution. We are very generous there, we try to be there. So it will be fine. It was always fine, or most of the time fine, in the previous years. Of course, some people might see it a little bit different. I cannot avoid this. Submission is done using OLAT in groups of maximum 2 students, and I would suggest you also make use of this. Not only is it easier for our TAs to give feedback or to look at your solutions, but also it's less work for you. But note, of course, in the exam, you have to know the contents of all the exercises, at least this is like the we don't say you need to have know only half of it if you worked in a group. So in the end, you should work also here in groups, meaning to work together and not just fully distributing the load and not being aware of what your partner did. So every exercise sheet comes with a deadline. The deadline is usually Monday at 4 p.m. Kaiserslautern local time. And as I said, the submission can be done or should be done in groups. And there's one PDF to be uploaded per group, per exercise sheet. In addition, each student has to individually, because it's not possible to do it in groups so easily, so every student has to individually claim the points for solved assignments. There will be checkboxes, and you marking the checkboxes corresponding to what you think was sufficiently answered in the submission you uploaded. If you're putting a checkbox, that means that the tutors will go over that and see if you deserve the point, and if not, they will deduct it or will not give the point. And in case it's not sufficiently answered or like wrongly claimed, also this can have consequences. This brings me to this slide here. So a note on wrong claims, but just mentioned, and plagiarism, which is even worse than wrong claims. So if you're copying solutions from previous years or submissions of your peer students, which are not your group partner, obviously, this will lead to it being immediately excluded without any discussion from the exercises. So the anti-exercises, basically that means you cannot take the exam. Yeah, and there won't be, as I said, there won't be any discussions. We have seen this previously whenever the case is clear. And believe me, we have seen this more often than I really would have liked to see. But it happens 3-4 times a semester, you're out of this course this semester. And if it's a mandatory course, and sometimes for bachelor students this can happen, particularly in socioinformatic, and also for master if you're specializing in our field, this is also mandatory, then I would not risk to wait 1 year. But in the end, you have to make the decision. But yeah, don't do this. And the wrong claims, it's not as harsh, the consequences, but still. So if you're putting a checkbox, because checkboxes are summed up automatically, and probably you will have quite many students in the course, so the tutors will sample to some extent also these checkboxes you put to see if the point was gets granted or not. And if you did not upload any solution to, and let's say, assignment 2A or 2, and you still put the checkbox, then this could be also interpreted, or will be interpreted, as a cheating attempt to claim a point you did not work for. And in extreme cases, there will be 0 points on the entire sheet, but the default is to get 0 points, obviously, on the assignment that you were trying to claim points for. Okay. Well, yes, one thing more here about the wrong claims. So if we have, let's say, assignment 2, and there's A, B, and C, this means that you should also upload solutions to A, B, and C, so not leaving out any of them. Right? Does not mean that all of them have to be correct in order to get the point. Yeah, we will be generous there and fair in order to allow you to reach the 35 points also, because we wanted you participating in the exam. Also, this sounds a bit funny when I'm saying this now, but we want that. But we want also that you look at all of these A, B, C, because we put them for a reason, because we think they are important to learn something. So if you're leaving out C, so there's no upload for C, but there's something proper done for A and B, you will get 0 points on the assignment 2, right? And leaving out something is equivalent to writing total nonsense there, right? But again, we will be generous there, but if it's clear that you didn't even try more than 5 minutes to do a solution, then this will be the same as leaving it blank. Yes, Yes, the slides I mentioned already, they will be out handed out in one large chunk. There will be, of course, like always, some little typos and clarification required, and we will have a separate file called errata in OLAT, and this will be filled as we go. Hopefully this will be very small in the end. Slides will be available in English, also in German, but as I mentioned already, the English one is the one that is relevant for our definitions and exams. There should be pretty much 100% complete or identical, both versions, but still, since the official language is English here, at least for the videos and the slides, we will take the English one as the official one. Also, since it's the same LaTeX document, mistakes will be fixed in both anyway, if we find them, so there should not be a problem. Exercise sheets will be published in OLAT every Tuesday, and as I mentioned, the submission is usually the following Monday at 4 p.m. local Kaiserslautern time. And the discussion of solutions will be on Wednesday, and here, of course, also it should be mentioned on Friday. You see already the first mistake we find in the slides. So basically, the discussion of solutions will be in the TA sessions as we have planned them. So a few words on content. So probably most of you have seen already the undergraduate course or have attended it in your home universities or here in Kaiserslautern. You did it in the summer, then you attended my course or Professor Desloch's course, which should be pretty equivalent. So we assume that you have attended such an undergraduate course or such an introductory course on database systems. We will not recap basic concepts like SQL and so on. There also is a video uploaded on recap. We just have a brief walkthrough, so the fundamentals, so you can see what we discussed in the undergraduate courses or course. Still, if you lack some details, you would probably need to have a book to read something up. Okay, so the content of this very course, database systems, this winter semester, we will start with query evaluation to see where the performance can be improved or where performance is spent in terms of where the runtime is spent. So access costs we will look at, then buffer management. Probably you have already heard about LIU or FIFO, first in, first out. We will have a bit closer look and introduce a few more of these. Then index structures. We assume that you know what a B+ tree is or a B tree is. And now we will look a bit closer what kind of different indices we can have with such an index, like with a B+ tree index, in terms of being a clustered index or an unclustered index. Why some index is good for range queries and the other one is not? And what does it mean? How does the index make use of the actual storage of tuples on hard disk? Index tuning means we want to understand which indices should be created for a certain workload in order to speed up performance. And then we will look, what we did not do in the undergraduate course, we look at the implementation of operators. Usually in the undergraduate course, we just said, well, there's a join, right? But there are multiple different ways to implement a join. And one way to implement a join is called the sort merge join. And the sort merge join requires these relations, the input relations, to be sorted. And in order to make this working also if the memory is limited, we also look at a method called external sort. Then for query optimization purposes, we also look at histograms and so-called sketches, which are compact summaries of database content and statistics. Then next we look at performance tuning. And something which is kind of funny, because in the undergraduate course we talk about schema normal forms. So you want to make a schema, database schema, consisting of relations that have certain fulfilled requirements in terms of redundancy, freeness, and so on. And now we introduce schema denormalization, which is the other way around. We discuss ways where redundancy in schemas can be beneficial for performance. We also look at query unnesting, so at larger, more complex SQL queries, and how you can gain performance. You can help the database system to unnest these in order to have better performance than brute force evaluation of complex nested queries. Very briefly also on multi-query optimization and on materialless views. For the main chapter on query optimization, we will briefly recap rule-based query optimization, which is also done in the undergraduate course. We will look at cost models for joins, and then eventually in a larger topic on the problem of join ordering. Yeah. Join ordering is possible because joins are commutative and associative. If you have more than two relations in the join, you have multiple possibilities to compute a join result. And we will see how we can find good or optimal join plans for such join trees or for join queries. Then a large chapter, index structure and hashing. As I said already, we assume that you know what a binary search tree is and also what a B plus tree is and a B tree. We will look at indexing multidimensional data here in this lecture, namely the R tree. Also on handling high dimensional data with many more than 10 dimensions using LSH. Then back to trees, we look at quad tree, PR quad tree, KD tree. And then also we look at metric space indexing, for instance, using the generalized hyperplane tree. Then in the undergraduate course, when we talked about hashing, we used usually some very simple modulo hashing. And then, well, at least what I say is then that this is not really good, because if the data is growing, so there's more and more data inserted in these hash tables, there can be very many overflow buckets. And then the performance of this hashing can degenerate to a linear performance. And you don't want that. You want to have constant or near constant performance, O of one, if you're using hashing. We will look at two very prominent approaches, extendable hashing and linear hashing, that allow the data to grow and grow, and the hash functions are adapted without a major global reorganization being necessary. Then, following this, we look at nearest neighbor queries. So if you have a point in a data set, and this point is now acting as the query point, and you want to retrieve from the database those points, or also like spatial objects, which are closest to this query point. And we will do this using the R tree. We look at algorithms that find top K results, or the best K results, very efficiently. Specifically, we look at FAQ and threshold algorithms, and also on Skyline queries. Skyline queries have a very nice motivation example. So you have two-dimensional data. So you have hotels, and hotels have a price, and they have also a distance to the beach. And the hotels which are very cheap, and they have a small distance, they're of course preferred, right? And if you have a hotel, let's say, which is positioned here, so it costs 80 euro per night, and is like 500 meters away from the beach, and there's another hotel which is let's say costs 150 per night and is 1 kilometer away from the beach, then we say that the cheaper hotel, which is also closer to the beach, dominates this one here. And the pink one does not have to be considered, because the red one is in both dimensions better than the pink one. And if there's one hotel which is only 50 bucks per night, but it's also like 700 meters away, between the blue and the red one we cannot really distinguish, so both would be part of a so-called skyline, because these two are not dominating each other. And so we cannot make a decision between the two. One is cheaper but further away, the other one is more expensive but closer, but the pink one for sure is not really good because it's expensive and far away. Right? This is the concept of skylines. Then a big chapter, a big part, transaction management. Probably you have all seen basics already in the undergraduate course. We look at concept and some anomalies that are important to consider, and then going into serializability theory and different classes of histories that are avoiding or not avoiding the anomalies that we have looked at. Then synchronization and locking protocols are important to allow deserializability for some classes, and this is also what is implemented in many database systems. And after we did this, we look at logging and recovery, what happens if a database crashes, what information we have to write to persistent storage in order to have it available when the system restarts. Then briefly, outlook on recent developments in the area of database systems, particularly column stores and in-memory databases. In-memory database is kind of clear what that means. So it's pretty much mainly in RAM. It's not really fully in RAM because of persistency guarantees, but it operates mainly in memory, in RAM. And column stores are interesting because if you're looking, we never really talked about this in the undergraduate course, but if you're looking at a relation with rows and columns, and these here, the rows are also called tuples where information is stored in, for instance, the student name, matriculation number, and semester number, and so on. And usually what you're doing when you're writing this table on disk, you're writing the first tuple, and you're writing the next tuple behind it, and so on. So you're writing your disk full of these tuple after tuple. This is called row store, row after row. And column store would write all of the matriculation numbers, and then following that, all the names, and so on. So column after column. Depending on the database workload, one or the other is preferred. If you want to compute the average semester number, which let's say this is the column with the semester number, and all of the semester numbers are stored next to each other on disk, you only have to read this green block. If you want to execute the same query for the row store, you have to get the matriculation number from here, from there, from there, from there, from there, and from there. So everything here that you're reading in between, you're reading without being really required, right? So it's wasting performance. We will have a look on this. Then we will have a brief outlook on or overview on probabilistic databases. That's a very interesting concept. So if you have a database, we always assume that the data stored within the database is exact and correct. But often it's not the case. For instance, if you have handwriting and you do some detection of handwriting and you have a number like this, and then you say, okay, is it 183 or is it 783? Depending if you in US often write a 7 like this, whereas in here we would write a 7 like that. So it's but anyway, so if you're doing handwriting recognition and it's not really clear, so what do you write in the database? Do you write that this is like 183 or is it 783? Right? And then if you're writing both, you have different interpretations, because with 50-50 likelihood it is an 183 or 783, and so on. And this has like consequences for the query evaluation, and we will look at what is called intentional and extensional query evaluation semantics, and also the complexity behind that, but very briefly. Don't be scared on this, of this. Then MapReduce is a famous programming paradigm or data processing paradigm introduced by Google some years already ago, and we will see how we can do that. Basically, it's a framework to execute queries over multiple instances, compute instances of a data center. It has multiple applications, also from web search, ranging from web search to database joins and so on. And we will focus here on computing relational joins in MapReduce. There are certain amount of literature, actually tons of literature, on such an important and old topic, database systems. We mention three quite popular books, which are general and quite big books on general concepts of database systems, which is the first one, Garcia Molina, Alman Widom. This is also called Database Systems, the Complete Book, so it's quite big, as the name suggests. And this is very nice, and also El Masri Navate, also very good, and Ramakrishnan Gerke is a bit older, but it also has some very nice parts in it. Sometimes it's good to look at multiple books to see because all, not all books capture all topics in the same details, and also the explanations sometimes are better in one book than the other. So when I created the slides, I was also looking at multiple books, and hopefully I picked out the best for each of the chapters. Then there are, and there are more, of course. There's also Silberschatz, if I remember correctly, one book, also very good. And so there are many books on database systems. And there are specialized books on certain topics. For instance, there's a huge book by Hanan Samit, Foundations of Multidimensional and Metric Data Structures. It's one book only for index structures. So when I would suggest, if you taking this course, or you want to go a bit deeper in this, or you have problems understanding the concepts based on my explanations or the slides, and you might want to get one of these books. And these books here are a bit special. I probably suggest you would get them from the library if you have to look up certain specific questions you have. So this one, the first one is only on index structures, and the second one is only on transactions, the book by Wycombe and Fossen, Transactional Information Systems. And then, since this is such an old topic, an important topic, of course, there are also books in German language. For the books here, I think for at least for this one here, I'm quite sure, and I think also for this one, there are also German translations. For the introductory database concepts, this one is a good book by Kemper and Eichler, Datenbanksysteme. There are also more recent editions now. But this might be a bit too shallow for this advanced course on database systems, so I would not recommend getting this one for the current course. If you want to have a German book on the current course, then this one is highly recommended. Yeah? By Theo Herder and Erhard Rahm, Datenbanksysteme Implementierungen. It's a bit older, but doesn't matter. This is a very good book on implementation issues on database systems. Yeah? But in any case, these are wider. So I would suggest if you're getting a translation or maybe even the original version, this should be good. Other than that, probably this one is even better for some specific questions on implementation details than any of these books are. Right? We have many copies of that one, if I remember correctly, here at the university or the computer science library, because Professor Herder was or is still since many years a professor in our department. Okay, that's it, I guess. So please have a look at the book recommendations and also at the regulations. If you have questions regarding the regulations in particular, but also the books and everything else, please feel free and contact us without hesitation, because particularly the regulations are of course important to get started correctly with, not that you're not getting the exam qualification because there was a misinterpretation or something we put here on the slides or I said. So in case of doubt, always ask us.